Good morning, welcome to the 14th meeting of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone in the room to ensure their mobile phones are on silent. It's acceptable to use mobile devices for social media, but please don't take photographs or record any proceedings. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. Today's decision is whether we should consider our approach to legislative consent motions in private. And at this and future meetings, it's normal practice to consider approach papers in private. Are we agreed? Thank you. The second item on the agenda is two evidence sessions on obesity. What we'll do is I'll introduce myself first, then we'll go around the table very briefly to introduce ourselves, and then we'll crack on. So I'm Neil Finlay. I'm the Labour MSP for Lothians, Chair of the Health and Sport Committee, and welcome you all to the meeting today.
I'm Lorraine Tulloch. I'm the Programme Lead from Obesity Action Scotland.
I'm Claire Hawkey. I'm Deputy Convener of the Committee and the MSP for Rutherglen.
I'm Tom Arthur. I'm the MSP for Renfrewshire South.
I'm Nanette Newtry. I'm Professor of Physical Activity for Health at the University of Edinburgh, and I lead our research centre there.
I'm Miles Briggs. I'm Conservative MSP for Lothian Region.
Ian Findlay. I'm the Chief Officer of Paths for All.
Claire Hislop. I'm Organisational Lead for Diet and Obesity Prevention at NHS Health Scotland.
Good morning. My name is Alex Cole Hamilton. I am the Liberal Democrat MSP for Edinburgh Weston, and my party's health spokesperson.
Alison Johnston, MSP for Lothian.
I'm Linda Bald, a Chair in Behavioural Research for Cancer Prevention at Cancer Research UK and the University of Stirling.
Richard Lyle, MSP for Uddingston and Belsom.
Good morning, I'm Celia Neesons from Nourish Scotland.
Morning, Mary Todd, Highlands and Islands MSP.
Good morning, my name's Joyce Thompson. I'm here on behalf of the British Dietetic Association.
Hi, good morning everyone, I'm Colin Smith, MSP for South Scotland.
Good morning, I'm Drew Walker. I'm the Director of Public Health in NHS Tayside, here representing Scottish Directors of Public Health.
Ivan McKee, MSP for Glasgow Proven.
Okay, thank you all very much for that. Donald Cameron will likely be late. I think his plane is stuck on the tarmac at Stornoway or somewhere like that, so hopefully he will join us in a wee while. Okay, we're just going to begin. Alison, would you like to begin?
Yes, thank you, Convener. I would like to ask those experts who've joined us this morning why it is the case that Scotland has the worst weight outcomes of all the UK nations and amongst the worst of any OECD nation. And that being the case, given the potential that action in this agenda has to transform lives for the better and save the NHS a great deal of resource, why is this not a national priority? Thank you. And
okay, who'd like to begin? Linda?
I think we've seen some fundamental changes in our environment in recent decades. I mean, the Scottish Parliament has been very courageous on tobacco and alcohol, and the changes that we've seen, particularly in smoking, didn't happen because people decided not to smoke. They happened because we changed the environment and the opportunities that people had to make healthier choices. And I think what we've seen in Scotland in recent decades is that we have very available, very cheap foods that are high salt and sugar and fat, that people find they can afford, and we don't have the diet that we should for our children. And in addition, obviously, we have seen, have not seen an increase in physical activity, and we don't have an active society. And Cancer Research UK is hugely concerned about this. I think it is probably our biggest future public health challenge. It's the biggest preventable cause of cancer after smoking. For people who don't smoke, it is the single biggest preventable cause. And I do think it's a public health crisis. And unless we take action, our modelling shows that we will have almost 700,000 additional cases of preventable cancers in the UK over the next 20 years.
Thank you.
Is it? You said it was a future challenge, is it not a present challenge?
I think what I would like to argue, and I'm sure my colleagues in the room would agree, is that we need a comprehensive strategy that's a long-term strategy. I don't think you can change this overnight. So it's a current challenge now, but I hope that the actions you're considering will take us forward for many years so that the children who are starting school now will not have potentially the same burden of obesity as those that have come in the last 10 or 20 years.
Yeah, I would echo what Linda has said. We know Scotland has some of the worst statistics, but we're not alone in the world in facing this challenge. There are a lot of other countries facing the challenge as well, so it's not just unique to us. But we know from the evidence, Food Standards Scotland have published evidence over the last few years that have shown that our poor diet has been ingrained. I mean, it's 15 years of missing dietary goals. So it's been over decades that this has been happening. And it's again about the same things that Linda was outlining, the environment around the diet and physical activity that people are taking, and that is the physical activity levels and a poor diet are the causes for it. And again, this is we have policies on this, but we need to move further with the kind of fiscal and regulatory measures. There's been action that has been taken over a number of years, but we feel Obesity Action Scotland certainly firmly believe that now is the time for more of the kind of fiscal and regulatory measures that are needed to tackle the poor diet that Scotland faces, and we need to take action to change the food environment so the healthy choice is the easiest choice for the consumer, and we need action at retail and out of home sector level to see that change.
Ian.
I think one of the reasons for the statistics you mentioned is that 40% of adults do not meet the physical activity guidelines in Scotland, and we believe that physical activity has a very important role to play in helping to prevent obesity, as well as a complementary role in addressing it. I think we've done extremely well over the last 50, 60 years in designing physical activity out of our lifestyles and having much more sedentary lifestyles. And I think we need to look at mechanisms for trying to incorporate physical activity more into our everyday lives, whether that be for leisure or for everyday short journeys. As to why it's not a priority, that's a mystery to me as well. Because it represents such fantastic value for money. I mean, we are really talking about prevention here, curing the cause rather than treating the symptoms, and spending a little now on physical activity and tackling obesity will save the nation a lot of money. A recent report by NHS Health Scotland calculated that physical inactivity cost the Scottish Health Service £94 million per annum. So by increasing physical activity, we could significantly reduce this. So I think the solutions here are very good value for money and quite easy. And why it isn't a priority is a very good question.
Drew.
Okay, I just wanted to pick up on what Lorraine was saying about the healthy choice being the easy choice. At the moment, the unhealthy choice is the easy choice. There's a bit of jargon we use. We talk about an obesogenic environment, an environment where it makes it very easy to overconsume calories and to take too little physical exercise. And we need to turn that on its head. We need to make it much more difficult to consume less attractive to people to consume too many calories, and much easier for people to be more active more often.
Convener, you know, Scotland's record in this area is worse than comparable UK nations. I mean, is our environment here particularly obesogenic? Because the report last week suggested actually we had a pretty good environment for physical activity, yet we're still not engaging. And, you know, is this proliferation of easily accessible junk food, is there more of it here?
So 40% of foods in the UK are bought on promotion, and that is the highest rate of any nation in Europe. So if we just start with the sales environment, there are very clear indicators that some of the options that people have available to them are driving them in the wrong direction. So that's just one example, but there are probably specific other examples where Scotland, because of some of the drivers, is worse than other European nations.
Celia.
I agree very much with what Lauren and Drew said. I think the reason why in Scotland the issue is so bad is because of a combination of three very important factors, one being inequalities and a quite high level of poverty in the UK as a whole, but also in Scotland. And it is proven that people on low incomes and with very small budgets for food will prioritise calories over nutrients. And the excessive amount of calories that we eat is what is making us fat. So that's one reason, and obesity is a social issue, so we need to look at it as this. Another reason, I think, is the food culture, which is not, Scotland is not famous for its food culture. And so the lack of skills, the lack of time dedicated to eating, and the lack of habit to cook a good meal with a lot of vegetables, like the Mediterranean diets. And then the very important factor is, adding to these two factors, is the food environment that is extremely obesogenic. And we haven't so far taken a comprehensive approach to change the environment. It is still extremely difficult, even for people on higher incomes, to eat healthily. So this is what we need to look at.
Nanette?
I'd just like to follow up my colleague's comments about physical activity and its importance. I think I sit in the National Strategic Group for Sport and Physical Activity, and I think Scotland has admirable strategy in physical activity, and it has a very nice outcomes framework which is now monitored. What we're failing to do is implement that at scale and with resources. So we have a number of small projects, but they don't appear across the whole country. We have a great set of plans, but no resources to push them forward to change the environment or encourage the one-fifth of people who are doing less than 30 minutes a week. And that's where we could do with improvement. And that will undoubtedly help the obesity programming and agenda that we have.
Emery?
Interested in the international comparison. So I understand that we have an obesogenic environment here in Scotland and possibly in the whole of the UK. And I hear that we have this 40% of our food is bought on promotions. Why is that? Is that because we're less regulated than other countries, or, you know, do we just love a bargain?
That is because of our retail environment and some of the competition that you have between retailers, but also I think adding to the points you made about some of the traditional choices that we've made in Scotland around confectionery and some of the things that people perhaps prefer to eat. So if those are available and we have children consuming them from very early in life and even pregnant women who have diets that are high in salt, sugar and fat, then those things come together. So you have people's choices or preferences, which are established very early, and then you have an environment where because of a commercial environment, the retailers are driven to sell things very cheaply. And that, the price, I always talk about the four P's: price, promotion, place, and the product. And the price is something that we can take action on as a single measure.
Hey, Colin.
I'm keen to pursue a point raised by Celia, and that's around the issue of inequality. Obviously, the link between obesity and deprivation is well documented, particularly among women and children. And I'm keen to get the panel's views on why that's the case, to what extent existing strategies sufficiently deal with that particular issue, and what would you see is needed in any future strategy to tackle that particular problem?
I can't speak about the physical or the medical reasons for that, but I think in terms of children, one reason could be that marketing is extremely aggressive and schools are surrounded by convenience food outlets, and it is extremely difficult for children to ignore all that marketing and that convenience food that is readily available to them. School meals, of course, have also a role to play in this, and free school meals have been very beneficial in helping children eat healthily. So having school meals across the board and also looking at what children can eat outside school time is very important.
At the beginning, I think it was yourself, Linda, who said this was a crisis. Is there any of the panel who think it is not a crisis? Is there any obesity sceptics in the room? No. It's very difficult, even in the media, to find people who are... You would always normally get someone who would argue the contrary line. I've never heard one yet. So we do seem to be in a crisis, and that requires a very... fundamental response to this. When we look at the some of the commentary on the obesity roadmap, it says that a number of interventions aimed at attitudes, values and behaviours outweighed those aimed at costs and regulation. This was at odds with the balance of international evidence on what would be the most effective, it would be most effective for obesity prevention. Is that a general view that we're actually going down the wrong route on this?
I wanted really to respond to Colin's question about policies, but okay, if I could just reflect on the...
No, do that first if you
if
you want
if
to.
I could just reflect on the where obesity is it a crisis? Yes, it is a crisis, but it's been a slow burning crisis. If we had been sitting here 10 years ago, I think it would have been quite difficult to have got support for saying that we were in the middle of an obesity crisis, because people hadn't woken up to the problem that we've got. Joyce Thompson and I published in Tayside our healthy weight strategy 11 years ago, and I was criticised by my board for wasting my time and the time of my colleagues and partners on something which was nothing to do with public health. It's inconceivable that that comment would be made now, because in the intervening years, we have woken up to the crisis of obesity and of the threats to everything that's important to us. So things have moved on. And in relation to policies, to pick up on a point others have made already, we have fantastic policies in Scotland. If we were to implement all of the policies that we've got, we would be a long way down the road of tackling the obesogenic environment and all the things that are pushing us in the wrong direction. The issue is not shortage of policies. The shortfall is in the implementation of the policies that we already and that's everybody's. That's not pointing the finger at anybody in particular. That's all of us. Well. I think others might want to come in on this, but we have the route map. It's got a whole range of things that that need to be done. Some things have been done, but a point was being made: things not being done at scale. So there are lots of good initiatives being taken all across Scotland, but the successful things are not necessarily being scaled up. They're not necessarily being adopted by everybody with the level of investment required right across the country. And there's lots and lots of examples of that. But other colleagues might want to give more detailed examples of that.
Yeah. What I would say is, and that's responding to a few of the things that have been raised, the review that looked at the obesity route map, and that was a statement that was in our evidence that we submitted, the statement that you read out, convener. It looked at it and it said that there was the number of interventions did look at attitudes, values and behaviours. And what I think we found is, similar to what Drew said, is the awareness of this issue has grown substantially over the last decade. And I think that has probably partly had an input to the inequalities changes that we've seen, because we know that the least deprived people will respond to those messages. They'll respond to the health messages that they hear and they'll do something about it. So that may have been what has widened the gap. But we need to think about other ways of addressing it to make it fair across the board and to help the most deprived people in society. So I wanted to highlight that. And that's one of the reasons why we need to move much more towards these interventions around cost and regulation. And as Drew said, 10 years ago, they would probably have been fairly difficult to take forward, because there wouldn't have been the level of support and the level of acknowledgement of the issue. But we're now at a stage where those things do have a lot more support. There's more recognition of the problem. And the original obesity route map did recognise the need to change the food environment. It's not new. But we went through a process of voluntary approaches to working with the industry over the years. But we now know that we haven't progressed as far as we need to progress with those voluntary approaches. And we now need to think about regulation being introduced to tackle it.
Just picking up on that point then, I'd be interested to hear what the panel's thoughts are on regulation and what regulation they think would help to sort of tie in with some of the obesity strategies and help to reduce overall weight.
Can I just go back to the four P's of price, promotion, place and the product? So ideally we need to change all of those, and those are things that we can change. So some people have talked about promotion, and you asked the question, convener, about does anybody disagree with the need for action on obesity? I think the problem with promotion, so advertising of foods that are unhealthy, is that if people have these other initiatives where the attitudes and behaviors have changed and they're trying to make healthy choices, they're actually pushing against basically what is a tsunami of advertising, because you're surrounded by, on television, billboards, etc., promotion of very cheap foods. And we did some research through Cancer Research UK with children where they talked about how they felt when they saw those ads. And one of them said they wanted to lick the screen, you know, the TV screen. It's really compelling things, and it's difficult to push against that. So that's promotion. We've talked about price, which is the other driver. The product also, reformulation is something we might want to talk about. I know Food Standards Scotland have talked about lowering the salt and sugar in particular products. But crucially, place as well. So when we look at where products are promoted, for example, we know that some junk food that's on the rotunda displays at the end of the supermarkets, that can increase sales by up to 50%. So those are things around the environment. Those are all regulatory changes. And just finally, on public support, we know that about almost 80% of the Scottish population agree with action on junk food advertising, and just slightly less on price promotions. So the public are in favor. Industry won't necessarily like this. They're likely a different voice. But I think things have changed. But those are some of the mechanisms I think we need to focus on.
Claire.
Thanks. I mean, I think what we need to do is we also need to recognise some of the actual really successful policies we have had in Scotland over the last few years. And certainly, you know, we've done a lot of individual work around schools, and, you know, we're doing work in hospitals, various other different areas. But I think what, certainly from our perspective, what we realise is we've not all come together. And these things are quite often have to be you know, some choices that people have to make, so their individual behaviour changes. And we need to kind of start to look how we can actually affect the population rather than relying on interventions which make people have to actually choose to take these up. And that's why some of the measures that other people have been suggesting today will be, you know, more successful for making change wider. And I think as well, in terms of inequalities, that also makes we're less likely to widen any gaps if we do things on a kind of more population-wide basis. And I think that's in the past, maybe where the gaps widen slightly around obesity is because we've done interventions which are only chosen by those who can make that choice. So things like leaflets, and for example, are only going to be read by people who are interested. So I think we need to look at, when we're addressing, you know, this new strategy, is making sure that it's holistic and we're taking all the different approaches, including environment, and not just relying on people's individual intervention basis. So.
Ian.
Convener, you asked for some specific examples. I could give you two. The physical activity strategy has now been in place for over 20 years. It's internationally renowned as a good strategy. A lot of very good interventions taking place within that strategy, I mean, such as the work that Paths for All does in the walking schemes. And we're seeing some hopeful signs that the Scottish Household Survey showed a 5% increase in walking. But I would agree very much with what Professor Muttry is saying, and that these need to be scaled up, these sorts of interventions. And if they were scaled up to a bigger level, I think we would see more progress. So that is about long-term sustained funding, leadership at all levels. So that's one example of where we've got a really good strategy in place, but implementation needs to catch up. The other is the National Transport Strategy. The National Transport Strategy has a hierarchy where it puts walking and cycling at the top, followed by public transport, and then the private motor car. However, as we all know, probably reality is more real in terms of priorities and funding. Recently, Transport Scotland undertook a study into how to increase physical activity and how to best implement the physical activity policies we have, the active travel policies that there are. And that came out with the same sort of conclusions. It's about long-term sustained funding. So there's two examples, I think, where we have very good policies in place, but what we need to do is make sure that the implementation of these policies catch up. And I think we're starting down that journey. I think that there's a lot of hopeful signs, but that implementation needs to be accelerated to see the population scale change.
Yeah, we seem to be very good at writing strategies, but not very good at implementing. Is that what you're saying?
This is tongue-in-cheek, but a number of our partners hold an active travel conference each year, and 3 years ago we asked a policy guru from Europe to come across to have a look at Scotland, look at our policies and how we're implementing walking and cycling for everyday short journeys. And the person came across for a week, and his conclusion to the conference was, you must have a policy not to implement your policies. Because his conclusion was that the policy framework is actually very good. And really what we need to now focus on in Scotland is implementing those policies and make sure the leadership and the resources are there to bring that about.
Nanette?
Yeah, I can follow up on that. Thank you. 2 points, one about inequalities and one about potential regulation. And I think for physical activity, inequalities is different than from food consumption. And the mode of activity that people are doing are critical. Sport has a lot of inequality, but active travel does not. And we've just analysed the active travel data. This is a good news story for Scotland. It is increasing in urban and rural for both men and women and across all social classes. And yet it's not part of our outcomes framework. We're not monitoring adult active travel. So I think what Ian said and what I'm saying is that that needs to feature in our implementation. The biggest inequalities for physical activity are age, and our older population potentially could benefit most but are doing a minuscule amount of activity in comparison to our younger generation, and gender. Universally, and Scotland's no different, men are more active than women, and that's an inequality we should try to close. In terms of regulation, I think there are tough choices. It's not easy to find a regulatory mechanism to increase activity, but it might be around active travel, and these are tough political decisions, such as restricting car access to town centres, pedestrianisation, increasing car parking charges, difficult political and unpopular decisions to make. But these sort of things we've seen from our European counterparts, where cycling is so much the norm that car usage is going down in Denmark, for example. These are decisions that will help create a more active environment, a less obesogenic environment.
Ivan.
Thanks, convener. There was a couple of things I wanted to just explore around about some data points. Although I'm tempted to come back and talk about the issues you've just raised there in respect to the planning system, because I think there's an issue there, and I'll maybe get onto that if I've got time. So it was first of all just to talk about the trends in terms of where we are, and if you look at the data that's there in the health survey, you kind of see in terms of obesity, and overweight statistics, you see a rise through the 90s and early part of the 2000s, and then for the last number of years, it seems to kind of flatten off. So I suppose it was just to explore that. Is that the reality, or is it, and is that a consequence of policy changes, or is that just a natural phenomena that it couldn't continue to rise at that rate forever? And the second issue I wanted to maybe try and explore is around about the cost implications of that. And I know there's been one or two numbers put out this morning. I know you were also talking about the impact on cancer. So I'd really like to understand the implication of that now and in the future, in a kind of macro sense, because if you look at the health service in Scotland, spends about $13 billion, right? And if we continue doing what we're doing, how much of an impact would increasing obesity have on those kind of numbers at that kind of big scale? And I'm assuming somebody's done the analysis between your typical average weight person, how much they cost the health service, and your typical obese person, how much they cost the health service over a period of time, to be able to factor that out. So I don't know if anybody's got any kind of comments in those areas.
Data, I'm sure other colleagues can talk about other conditions. I mean, I mentioned the modelling we'd done around the almost 700,000 additional cancer cases. If we had a 1% reduction in obesity each year in the UK, there would be about 40,000 fewer cases of cancer each year. And we know that would probably save around 40 million to the NHS. So there is modelling that has been done around that across the UK. So you can divide that by a factor. So those modelling figures have done for the UK. So we are very clear on the cost savings we could take. Just on your first question about the trends, I don't think we should be complacent. I think it's encouraging. I mean, there are issues with the data, particularly some of the issues around underreporting in some of the surveys, where we see in terms of calorie consumption, there's clearly underreporting. Then when we look at sales, we see there's a big gap. So people are not necessarily feeling comfortable about reporting what they consume. But I think we still have record levels. So even though we've seen a slight leveling off, which is particularly positive in some groups, I think we need to recognise that those are still historically high levels compared to other countries, and we know what the cost implications are.
So I suppose the question is that a result of policy, or is that a natural phenomenon? because it was a result of policy, then clearly we've started to do something.
Well, I think we have seen, I mean, I thought Ian and Annette's comments were very helpful around some of the fact that we have had these strategies and there have been some very positive examples, but it's not on the scale that we need to see it. I think that's the take-home message. Yeah.
On the plateauing of the data, just to expand a little bit on what Linda's saying there, it's easy to get misled by that plateauing. It looks like it's good news that, you know, the increases we were seeing some time ago have plateaued out. And but if that's if you look at the whole population as a as an average, if you break that down into socioeconomic groupings, you see a different story. What you see is that the level of overweight and obesity in more affluent populations has actually fallen slightly over the last number of years. Conversely, the number of people who are overweight and obese in our poorer populations, and this is adults and children, has actually increased slightly. So any complacency, that should wipe that away straight away, because we know that that is a significant contributor to the widening health inequalities that we see around us. So let's not be fooled by the average. We need to look at within that average and what it's telling us about different groups.
Joyce?
I would just certainly echo that was the point that I wanted to make as well, and also to highlight in terms of the surveillance data that we have the Child Health Surveillance Programme, so at school entry, so we have data on BMI in children, and thereafter we've got the Scottish Health Survey. So it would be very, very helpful if we had more consistent surveillance, for example, at secondary school entry as well. So I think we're limited from that perspective. As I say, Drew, I think you're absolutely right in terms of the difference in inequalities, which is particularly specific to children and women. But I wonder if I could also just add into that, and I completely agree with all of the comments made by colleagues, and it's highlighting, one, this is a complex issue, and two, we are talking about physical activity, sedentary behaviour and diet. But we frequently talk about it in this country without actually necessarily associating it with the situation of obesity. And this is particularly true for children, but also adults as well, in that we don't recognise ourselves as being overweight or obese. We don't recognise our children as being overweight or obese. And that tells me two things. One, most definitely we need to address the prevention side, which includes legislation, but we can't ignore the fact that a significant proportion of our population already suffer from the condition. Therefore, we need to support these individuals as well.
On the point of monitoring weight through like child's school career, does everybody agree that we should be doing that more?
Yeah, I think particularly in year six, where, I mean, in England, there is that routine weighing at that point as well. And I think that's the point you're making about secondary school entry. So fantastic that we're doing it when children start school, but let's do it a little bit further up the educational pathway as well, so we've got more data points and we can be more confident about the monitoring.
Okay. Celia.
I had a comment to make on the previous question.
That's okay.
So no, I'll
worries.
Just go back. On the question of regulation, I think one of the reasons why we haven't really made much progress so far is that we've been looking in silos and looking specifically at changing people's behaviours without changing the wider environment. And I think a framework that could be used to guide policy on this, and that is being used already by the Scottish Government on climate change, is the ISM framework. I don't know if people here are familiar with this framework. It's the individual social material framework that sees that individuals are part of a social context, which is itself part of the material context, and you cannot change individual's behaviour without changing the bigger context in which they are integrated. And I think looking at obesity with this lens would really help regulation and policy actions.
Okay. Marie, on your point you wanted to make that you raised before the meeting. Food promotions, I think.
Oh, yeah, the food promotions. But it's just, I mean, I am struggling to understand why our commercial environment is so significantly different from the rest of Europe. So I understand that it is much more competitive. But is there more regulation in other parts of the world? Or, you know, what is it that makes it so attractive for UK population to buy on promotion?
Do you want to comment on that, Lorraine, some of the analysis that's been done?
It's something that's still being looked at, and we're still trying to get a good international feel for it. I think it's less about the level of regulation and more about culture and the food culture that exists in other countries around how they eat and what they eat. And but we are looking at, as far as we can, for examples around the world, and we're seeing some countries that are bringing in other regulatory measures. And I mean, you all know the examples from Mexico about the sugar tax and Chile about advertising. But in terms of other European countries, it seems to be more of a cultural issue than regulation.
Anybody else on that issue?
Giving us a little bit more information about the Mexican sugar tax, because would anybody else be interested in that? We didn't get that in the submission.
Lorraine and I agree on almost all of this. There are some good examples from other countries on action on price, and I would recommend to you the Nourishing Framework, which has been established by the World Cancer Research Fund, where they have a database that looks at what all countries are doing on food promotions and other food action on healthy diets, and there's some useful comparators there. But just on Mexico, so they introduced a 10% levy, a tax on sugary drinks, which resulted in a 10% consumption over the period they were monitoring it. Interestingly as well, the intention of the revenue from the tax was that it would go back into public health, particularly providing cleaner water in schools and other measures that communities could use. So that's a really good... There has been criticism from commercial partners of that policy and the interpretation of the data, and this always happens in all areas of public health. But we can be relatively confident about the Mexican data that they have seen that 10% reduction. They had some of the highest levels of carbonated sugary drink consumption in the world, but unfortunately, we've got very high levels here as well. So it's an interesting example.
Just to add to that, the Mexico is a good example, and we've seen the consumption go down, and we've seen that sustained. There's now some evidence from the year two of the tax, and it's sustained the fall in consumption. The interesting aspect that Linda highlighted was the reinvestment and provision of water, which was a popular part of that tax.
Alex.
I've been really struck by the four P's that we've heard about today, and I'd like to focus on two of them related to this discussion we've just had on promotion as well. But first, in terms of place, I think that we've discussed availability and access to healthier options, and I reflect on the fact that, you know, I did some youth work in some deprived areas of Glasgow, and we were talking about nutritional eating with the young people we were working with, and then, you know, it was falling on deaf ears because actually there wasn't an outlet, a retail outlet within their roaming area, which actually stocked any of the healthy ingredients that we were talking about. But it's on the promotion and particularly targeting of advertising at children that I'd like to get the panel's reflections on. Often struck as a parent trying to buy healthily for my kids, but I find myself being duped into buying things which have no added sugar, but then you see the sugar content and it's astronomical, or the things which talk about calories, which vary calorie per 100 grams or per half portion or whatever, and that you actually have to really interrogate the back of the label to work out how many calories you're giving your kids, because that changes from product to product. And also those products which talk about being one of your five a day, which I absolutely took as gospel until I saw a program to say that actually there's a lot of producers kind of nefariously swinging the lead on that. I just wonder if you can talk specifically about the impact of advertising on children and how we better educate parents to buy better for their kids. Thanks.
Dominate at all, but if I just give you the example of one experiment that was done in Liverpool. So these were kids who were invited in, and they were shown TV ads, and some of them were shown adverts for toys, and the others were shown adverts for junk food. And then after that, they were allowed to go and have lunch in a room with a buffet, and it was monitored how much they ate. And the children who'd been exposed to the junk food adverts ate significantly more at that lunchtime than those who'd seen the toy adverts, and those levels of consumption were higher in the kids who were already overweight or obese. So that's just one example of promotion. I think what Cancer Research UK is specifically calling for is that the Scottish Government would strongly push and encourage the UK Government to introduce the pre-watershed ban on junk food advertising on TV, because even though people often say, oh, well, it's all about digital media nowadays, kids are looking at small screens, actually television advertising is still a major driver of consumption. But within Scotland, there are other things we could do in the retail environment on promotions, some of the devolved powers we have around advertising. And I think we should look very carefully at that, and there should be an analysis of where action could be taken that's within the powers that we have here.
Lorraine.
Yes, just to add to that, there's a lot of really great evidence coming from the work that Cancer Research UK are doing about how children do respond to adverts. And again, we would support a call for the 9pm watershed on TV advertising. But as Linda said, there are other devolved aspects to advertising that we would ask the Scottish Government to look at in terms of billboard and bus stop advertising and things that there are some controls that could be implemented within Scotland that could have an impact on the type of advertising that's seen by children. In terms of race around labelling, again, it's something that we're very interested in. There's a very complex mix of where the legislation sits for labelling, and a lot of it is at European level just now. So the timing is probably, it may be that once we're a bit clearer on where we're going with European aspects, we could look again at labelling and what that could offer us in terms of improving how people understand. And part of that labelling is also around understanding portion size, because there's a lot of confusion with the public just now around what the label tells you around how much you should eat and the portions that are available.
Ian?
Can I pick up on the question regarding data and particularly look at costs and money? Because I think the important point I'd like to make here is that a lot of the interventions we're talking about here, although they cost money, are a net saving. I mean, we are very much looking at preventative spend here, spending a little now to save money. I've already mentioned the figure of £94 million per annum, the cost to the health service of physical inactivity. But there's been quite a bit of work done on cost-benefit ratios and social return on investment studies. Looking at cost-benefit ratios, likes of Dr. Adrian Davis has done work on active travel cost-benefit ratios and looked at the cost of walking cycling infrastructure. And he's come up with cost-benefit ratios about 1 to 19. So for every £1 spent on active travel, you're getting about £19 of benefit. He compared that with road infrastructure, and I'm not against road and against cars, they are important, but if you compare that with road infrastructure, if a roads development gets a 1 to 2 cost-benefit ratio, then it's considered to be a really good piece of road infrastructure. On social return investment, I'm aware of 4 independently verified studies on walking and cycling infrastructure, and all of them show a ratio of about 1 to 8, either 1 to 8 or 1 to 9 for those 4 studies. So every £1 spent delivers £8 or £9 of benefit. And the top benefits in all of those 4 are health benefits. So it's physical activity, tackling obesity and the likes. So there is some hard data out there to show that these sorts of interventions work, they're good value for money, and taken over the long term are actually a net saving to the nation.
This the strategic plan for this committee highlights preventative spend, health inequality and cost-effectiveness has been our priorities, and all of that would seem to hit very squarely with this issue. But my issue is that a number of the things that people have mentioned around the table, like, you know, sport, particularly local sport or activity, local travel, active travel, things like older people's clubs, walking groups, all of these are funded by local authorities or were in the past. And if we are to address this, how on earth can we address this in a preventative way, tackling health inequality and getting value for money, if local government is going under the pressure that it is financially at the moment? Is it possible with the current policy agenda in terms of the finances of local government that we can address this? Yeah, Drew.
So the public sector more widely needs to be playing as full a role as it can. The very least we should expect is that the public sector doesn't add to the existing problem, and I wonder whether is the situation at the moment. If we think about the hospitals within the NHS, for example, we shouldn't be expecting people who are attending health facilities to be experiencing an obesogenic environment. but that's exactly what they do experience in far too many hospitals in Scotland. One of the first things you do when you go through the main door is you come across a commercial outlet which is marketing very heavily energy dense food. When you go into staff canteens, the choices, the food choices, are too often again high calorie, low nutritional value foods. So, just with it, I don't want to say too much about the local authority because I don't have so much knowledge about that. But at least within the NHS, we should be expecting the NHS to play a full role in not at least promoting obesity in the way that it currently does.
Celia? Yes,
on the point of cost effectiveness, well, regulation is quite cheap, I guess. It needs to be done well. And on that issue, I think it's really important that policymakers take a very comprehensive approach when looking at different aspects. And for example, when looking at advertising, a ban on TV advertising would be very positive, but it will just mean that resources will be channeled towards other sorts of channels of advertising. And for example, digital advertising is a huge issue. The WHO published a report quite recently on digital advertising to children, and it's quite scary. Through social media or pop-up ads on games that children play on their phone, tablet, advertising is everywhere, and that's really something that I think regulators need to look at. And I've got another point on the sugar tax as well. Nourish supports a sugar tax in principle, but we are not entirely positive about it because on one hand it tends to affect poorer families heavier, and on the other hand because if you tax sugar in some drinks, people will just take other drinks that choose other drinks that are cheaper. Also, drinks with aspartame and other fake sugars are not actually healthier than drinks with free sugar. So we're talking about another sort of tax that is a far way ahead, but we think would be much more effective, and we call it a multiple retailers and caterers levy. And this would apply to multiple retailers and caterers like Tesco, Asda, Greggs, McDonald's, etc. And it would tax the health difference between what they sell and what they should be selling us for us to feed us effectively. Because we've got those dietary goals set by the Food Standard Scotland, and we're not meeting them. But we can't meet them when everything that's in the shop is not compatible with those standards. So if supermarkets and other caterers and retailers had to report periodically on their sales, they know the content of their sales and know how many calories, how much free sugar, etc. they sell, and then pay the difference between that amount and the amount that they would have sold if they sold us healthy diets. It could be positive. If they sold more fruit and veg than we need to eat, then this will become a subsidy, but we're quite far away from there. But at present, for example, supermarkets sell about 30% of free sugars as a proportion of dietary energy, whereas the recommendation is that we eat only 5% of free sugar. So that difference within a levy would be applied to this difference, and that would really incentivize supermarkets and other caterers and retailers to look at how they market their food, look at reformulation, what are they selling us so that they'll have to pay less of that tax. And we think that would be a really more comprehensive approach, and then that money from this measure could be used to fund fruit and veg vouchers or the Healthy Start campaign or other such public health measures.
Yes, thank you. I probably would like to follow on from Celia's points there. I mean, it seems to me that we have two food cultures in Scotland because we export some very high quality food, seafood and meats and so on, that many people in Scotland, well, can't afford and never eat, and because of our food culture don't understand how we might best prepare it and so on. And I think, you know, Joyce made the point, I think, most adults, I think 3/4 of adults believe that their diet is healthy, but if 2/3 of us are overweight, then there's clearly a misunderstanding there.
And I get the impression from the evidence too that there's an understanding that reliance on individual behaviour change here won't suffice, that we need this societal shift. The Green Party manifesto did propose a levy on retailers and caterers, and I'd be interested to hear from the panel their views on that. I understand that the sugar tax has success, but I do believe too there are concerns about a potentially regressive nature and the impact on those on lower incomes. So I suppose it's about the fact that, yeah, private companies are benefiting from the sale of this very unhealthy, potentially addictive food, but the public purse is picking up the health bill at the end of the day and also impacting on people's quality of life. The other thing that I think we could be doing, look at our high streets. You know, I think we do need to be discussing where we're buying our food and what we're buying, because there has been an impact on the number of small independent retailers where you can go, get great advice, buy that fresh food and understand what to do with it. So I'd just like to understand, you know, from experts, what they think about the impact supermarkets have had on this agenda.
Yep, Claire.
We've been doing quite a lot of work in Scotland and looking at retail outlets, and we have obviously Supporting Healthy Choices, which is our kind of voluntary framework. And we've been doing things on a smaller scale through the Scottish Grocers Federation Healthy Living Programme, where we actually go into retailers and encourage them to provide fruit. We do work in hospital settings. So recently we've just introduced that all hospital retailers are actually having 50% of all their food on offer will be healthier options. But again, it's about setting that example, and we're not doing this across the board. So we need to look how we can scale these things up to actually have much more of an impact more broadly on the population. And I think that's where working with bigger retailers on price, promotion, positioning even, you know, where the products are positioned, how they advertise, you know, if they're using different mediums to attract a certain audience, and actually looking how we can change that balance. And that's what we need to do now to move it up to the next step. So we have got successful. I think there's now over half the convenience retailers in Scotland are within the Healthy Living programme, but we're still not seeing changes to the obesity level. So we need to take it to the next level and making it much more across the board to have an impact.
Ivan. Oh, no, sorry, I was going to come back to you, Ivan. I'll come back to you after we do this. Yeah, sorry.
I think it's just important to remember that there is no single intervention that is going to solve the obesity crisis that we face. It's going to take a whole package of measures. The McKinsey Institute did a report quite recently and looked at a whole broad range of interventions, and nearly all of them were labelled as cost-effective in terms of making a difference. And I think that's something we need to always remember and come back to. So there are individual things we can talk about, the sugar tax, retailers levy, there's all sorts of individual examples, and we need to look at the evidence behind all those individual examples, but we need a whole package of them. And the Public Health England evidence that came out recently did a very thorough review of the evidence around what ones would be most effective, and they put up their price promotions and advertising and marketing. So we really need to look at them and think about that evidence that already is out there when putting together a whole package of things.
Joyce.
Back to what Mr. Cole Hamilton raised in terms of some of the complexities and confusions around being able to select the right products for children, etc. I think what that reminds me to say is just to recognise the fact that there's significant issues with regards to health literacy in this country that we need to take cognizance of. So even though we produce the best materials, it's quite difficult for a significant chunk of the population to utilize them. So we need to think about that. Added to that, though, undoubtedly, under the guidance of the Scottish Government, we do have, for example, the Maternal and Infant Nutrition Framework. We've got various policy in relation to education. And granted, I work in a very practical arena, and therefore recognise how these have been very helpful in helping us to help the different populations in terms of some of the practical support that's needed in order to make those choices. And from the perspective of some of the information that comes through from a nutrition and dietary perspective, it is important clearly that the key messages are current and correct and also consistent. And sometimes if the knowledge and understanding about food and nutrition across the piece doesn't reflect that, that's when it can cause lots of mixed messages. The second point, I just want to go back to convener. You made some reference to the financial situation that we're in, particularly with regards to local authority and some of the decisions that they're having to make. And again, what that, in my head, points us towards is what else perhaps is possible out in our communities. So, for example, we have work underway locally where we are working with a small two parts of the community within Dundee in order to co-produce some preventative actions around the obesity agenda. Undoubtedly, I'm representing the British Dietetic Association. Dietitians most definitely are registered personnel with a nutrition background, and many are considered experts in the field of obesity prevention and treatment. But we also recognise that some of these interventions are perfectly possibly able to be delivered by volunteers or other individuals within the community with our guidance. So I think that perhaps provides us with opportunity, which is yet to be realised, but whereby we're actually utilising or working with the community as opposed to doing things for them.
That's fair enough, but if at the same time active travel's reducing, if at the same time as fresh fruit and veg co-ops are closing and all of that goes on, then we are really... We're scratching at a very tiny part of that. Not that we shouldn't do it, but to put that into perspective in the bigger picture, I think is very concerning when we see all the rest of what's going on. Linda, then Alex.
On a point about cost effectiveness, something we haven't touched on, which I hope the committee will note, and I know it's in some of our statements, is around the importance of primary care. So I think you made a very good point around interventions that can happen in the community. But of course, in Scotland, we've had an ABI programme around alcohol delivered by GPs and others, which has had some success. We now have a very good randomised control trial that shows the benefits of brief advice for weight loss delivered by GPs, where people who were randomised to receive the intervention lost double the weight of those in the control group. And we've done that for smoking. We know we can do it for alcohol, but we are nowhere near doing it for weight in primary care. And we know those interventions are really highly cost-effective. And that's something we can do in Scotland. So that's just another suggestion.
Alex?
I thank Joyce for picking up my point about awareness amongst parents as to what they should be buying for their kids and then the difficulty they face when they go into the supermarket with that, which I'm going to call a spade a spade here, and the duplicity and nefarious tactics of producers in trying to get round that awareness. And I think that actually, you know, I would argue that as a country, we do quite a good job of educating our parents as to what healthy food looks like. The information is there and available if you want it. Obviously, getting people to access that is different. But if you go into a supermarket, and I'm reflecting on this, that, you know, I bought a bag of toffee popcorn the other day because it said on it that a portion was only 112 calories. I thought, bonus. But that was for a 25-gram portion. If you look at what a 25-gram of portion of toffee popcorn looks like, is utterly heartbreaking. And you think, that's not a snack. That's not a treat. And then actually, to get you a fill, you have to absorb another 400 calories worth of it. But that's the thing. I think that, you know, we have to box clever with the producers. They have a responsibility. When I went into Sainsbury's to buy a banana, and the frequent items section only had cakes, buns, and chocolate confectionery on it, and I tweeted them and I said, maybe it would be cool to start a trend here, Sainsbury's. But I wonder if you could give us a bit more reflection on what we as politicians can do to stamp that out.
I think that's a good question. And I don't think there's any one particular solution to that. I mean, you talk about Sainsbury's, Tesco's, on the other hand, are giving away fruit and free fruit. As soon as you go into the store for children, which is actually a very positive move. So yes, I think that's a very difficult one.
regulation, the retailers will respond. So if things like price promotions and other marketing, there's restrictions on that, or we try to modify some of what they can do, we've already seen this with some of the debates around the sugar tax and changes that producers are making, they then think of alternatives, which might be sometimes a healthier alternative, because the retail sector can be a very important partner.
Ian, you.
Can I pick up the point on the point regarding the challenge of local authority capacity and just agree very much with that? If we are accepting that policy implementation is a priority rather than new policies, then the fact that there is reducing capacity and skills within local authorities, I think, is a huge challenge. Paths for All and a number of our partners like Sustrans, Cycling Scotland, Living Street Scotland, most of our work is delivered through local authorities. And so in a climate of reduced skills and capacity within local authorities, that is a big risk to the interventions that we're hoping to deliver. So I just recognise, I think that is a very important point as to the solutions to that. That's more difficult. But I think it is about prioritisation. I mean, in any organisation with less resources, you have to prioritise more and more. And I think the challenge for all of us is to make sure that obesity, physical activity is higher up the prioritisation list within local authorities than it is currently. I think it's also the fact that the agenda we're talking about today is not yet a vote winner, and that is very important at local authority level. And we're coming up to local authority elections in May, and if what we're talking about here today does not feature in the mailbags of local councillors hoping to be re-elected, then that is a bigger challenge. So I think we need to make sure that it is a priority with elected members as well.
And setting budgets.
Yep. Yeah. I mean, going back to the Active Travel Conference that I mentioned, we did have a panel of MSPs. It wasn't local authority councillors last year's conference. And one of the questions was asked, does walking and cycling feature in your mailbag? And it was all five main parties, and all five said no. Yet it's not something that features strongly in the mailbag for ourselves. So I think there's something around that. The other point I would make is I think, although it might be contrary to the concordat between national and local government, ring fence funding can be very useful. There is the Cycling Scotland's the Cycling Walking Safer Streets Fund. That is incredibly useful in this time of limited capacity within local authorities because that money has to be spent on walking and cycling. So I think finding a way of ring fencing funds rather than ring fence funds is something that could help.
Ivan.
Yeah, I just want to come back on some of the, just to make a point really, nobody needs to respond on this specifically, but just on the numbers that have come out, and the number of 94 million was mentioned as a potential saving. But if you look at it in the context, I'm shocked at such a low number, right? Because that is 0.8% of the total NHS budget. And even taking the 40 million number, if you work that through and you assume nobody in Scotland was overweight, that comes out at about 250 million saving in a Scottish context, which again is less than 2% of the NHS spend. So I'm kind of looking at that thinking, is that really true? If nobody in Scotland was overweight, would the NHS only save less than 2% of its total spend? And I'm kind of struggling to make sense of that. And it might be interesting for us to pick that up from a Spice point of view later and just do some more digging on that, because I would have thought the number would have been 10 times that, but just for the record. The thing I really wanted just to quiz you on, I kind of hinted on it before, was do you think there's stuff in the planning system that mitigates against active travel? And I mean, anecdotally, I once spoke to somebody very senior in a planning organisation and asked them why they were building housing estates with a couple of thousand houses with not even a corner shop in them. And he said, that's not a problem because if they need to buy anything, they get in their car and they drive to Asda. And that was the response. So do you think there is something in a planning system that causes problems there?
I think the planning system has an awful lot to offer in terms of tackling what we're talking about. I mean, as I said earlier on, I think we've done very well planning physical activity out of our lifestyles, out of our communities. Our planning system is, and when you see communities being developed, the motor car tends to dominate the way in which we plan our communities. So I think the planning system and the review of the planning system is a huge opportunity to address that, so that we make our communities more walkable, more cyclable so that we tackle both physical activity and obesity. It's also worth bearing in mind, we did some work as the Active Travel Alliance. 50% of the population either doesn't have a driving licence or access to a car. So looking at inequalities and health inequalities, about half the population, the private motor car is not an option. So if we are planning the way we travel, the way we design our communities around the motor car, then we are instantly excluding about half the population. So I think there's a big inequalities argument here, but I think there's a huge... I wouldn't say so much the planning system is a problem, but I think the planning system is a big part of the solution. And we've got the opportunity with the planning review coming up to make sure that walkability and cyclability of our communities, making sure that our services are close to where people are, is incorporated into the planning system.
Drew? Just to pick up on Ivan's point about the cost to the NHS, something that's entirely preventable, that's costing the NHS hundreds of millions of pounds every year, I think should be a priority for us. And we've got to bear in mind it's not just the NHS that bears the brunt of those costs. The local authorities, other public sector bodies are negatively impacted, as is the economy. We know that productivity in our workforce decreases as obesity levels increase. So there's triple, quadruple whammies coming cost-wise. And I think it's also important to consider this whole discussion around obesity in that wider context. There are other really important things about promoting healthier eating and higher levels of physical activity. The impact of a change in the current situation might have on the Scottish food industry, which are all entirely positive things. The Scottish public transport sector can benefit from a change towards more active travel. The impact on climate change, which I think is a really important one. The impact on pollution. And we know that people's health is being negatively impacted on by the emissions of vehicles and so on. The whole impact, we know that health inequalities, if we reduce health inequalities, it's not just people who live in our more deprived areas who benefit. The whole of our society benefits from having a smaller gap between the rich and poor. So there's win-win-wins all over the place, not just in relation to obesity, but in relation to our entire Scottish social and commercial economy.
Thank you, Karina. From what we've heard this morning, I think it sounds like you're in agreeance that there is a lot of good policy there. It's not just being implemented on the ground. And so I specifically wanted to ask the panel around this cross-portfolio approach, because we found last week when we were looking at mental health strategy, almost the Education Committee of this Parliament should have been pursuing a similar inquiry as we're doing. So to what extent do you think when policy is produced, it's then not being picked up by schools and not rolled out? And I think that's where we all have really good examples of walking buses and the Daily Mile, things like that in schools, but it's very few schools who are actually delivering these. So where do you think the problem is as a panel to actually making these policies be implemented?
Yeah. I would start by saying from my experience it's actually lack of resource. So we have a framework, a plan, an implementation opportunity, but no resource going behind that to move it out to local authorities, or incentive indeed for local authorities to pick up what is good government policy. And that is the gap that you've been talking about. Now, it's not a huge resource. I mean, the spend to save that we've been talking about is a small resource to make that happen at scale, at every point of delivery that we can imagine in Scotland.
And what sort of example, then, of not having that resource?
Well, we have a framework that says we will try to decrease the number of inactive people in Scotland. There it is. That's what we have to do. We've got some ideas of how to do it. No money to spend on doing that, or to receive from local authority, to receive from government to do that.
Lorraine.
Yeah. And the cross-portfolio part of it is very important. And one of the things I would come back to as an opportunity at the moment is the work that's going on around Good Food Nation. If we want to promote ourselves as a Good Food Nation and we have a Good Food Bill coming out, then we really need to think about... to be a Good Food Nation, we really need to also be meeting the health-based dietary goals of a nation. And so there's lots of opportunities for cross-portfolio work in this area. And you're right, we've already talked about things like healthcare settings and education and aspects like that. I wanted to just come back to some of the other issues that have been raised earlier around costs of obesity. And there is some information in some of this the SPICE briefing that was issued a number of years ago around cost, which... we need to gather more data on to try and update then, but it's looking like it costs between 360 million to 600 million to the NHS in Scotland annually to treat overweight and obesity. It's much more difficult to cost out because there are so many health implications of obesity. It's a broad range. It's not just cancer, it's type 2 diabetes, it's other complications in pregnancy. There's a broad range of health impacts associated with it, and that's why it's a much more difficult issue to cost up than some of the others. We also know that there are some of the stats you'd asked earlier around costs of, so we know that someone with a BMI of 40 probably costs twice as much to the NHS than somebody with a BMI of 20. So there's that kind of information is already available around costs.
Yes. I totally agree with what you said, and I totally get that. Yeah. I think we need to get that on the table, yeah, because the flip of that question is, if everybody in the country was fit and healthy, yeah, why would the NHS still need to spend 98% of what it spends today? Mm-hmm. And that's totally counterintuitive, okay, and we need to do some more digging on that.
You want to come back in?
Yes, it's just to follow this, yes, point for the 94 million that Ian quoted. That's £18 per person in Scotland for the cost of inactivity. But these are 2011 figures, and when Harry Burns was the chief medical officer, he thought that was totally underestimated. And one of the reasons is when you do these calculations, you can't include many of the things that Lorraine has mentioned. Mental health, for example, wasn't included in that cost because the data are not available in the same way as other more standard things like cardiovascular disease. So I think these are huge underestimates of the cost of inactivity from what Ian's point of view was. And am I allowed to just take another point? I wanted to raise the issue of individual and societal change. Now, I completely understand that we need a societal change, but if we say it's not an individual mechanism, we risk people not taking any action. Normative change happens when little groups of people start doing things differently and it becomes the norm. And so we must continue, I believe, to promote things that are proven to be individually focused interventions, providing they can be done at scale, and then we begin to change the culture from those individual approaches. And to take that point further, politicians and leaders around the table are champions for such change. Now, the Scottish Cancer Prevention Network has a lovely set of guidance about how to conduct a healthy meeting. I would give you gold stars for water and fruit that I see over there, but we've just ticked past the 60 minutes. No meeting should continue for 60 minutes without an active break, because sitting, as we're doing now, expends zero calories. Standing, as you might do for 5 minutes, doubles that calorie expenditure. Now, you are smiling because that is so far from the reality of how we conduct meetings that it's amusing to you. But there is part of the problem, and people need to take the active opportunities that they are given. We all managed, against some resistance, to walk up the stairs today, but the elevator was the thing that we were shown. You have a lovely building with lovely stairs, and we must be the leaders of part of that individual change in conducting healthy meetings and avoiding the totally sedentary society of the workplace that we've managed to create.
I'm glad you mentioned that. There's so many ways in which in this place that we do not practice what we preach. We have a gym in here that's not got any equipment in it and has never had equipment in it. And the reason is because politicians don't want to spend the money and take the criticism from the public that would incur. That's my understanding. But also in the way in which we conduct meetings, you're absolutely right, in which we travel here, some of us, all of that, we are very hypocritical, and I absolutely accept that. If only.
Remember never to use exercise as punishment. That's
Drew.
I'd
I think Nanette's actually picked up on the points I was on.
Celia.
I agree with what Professor Mitri just said, but I do want to highlight that as long as the environment is against people having healthy diets and being active, showcasing best practice and leading by example is not going to be scaled out. And especially in lower socioeconomic groups, they're just not going to be able to change their behaviors because they're not in a position to do it. But what I really wanted to say is to come back on Miles Briggs' point. I think it's a really important issue. How do we work together and make sure that the policies that we make are effective and are enforced? And something that Nourish Scotland has been doing is trying to work with people with lived experience. We do this in the field of food insecurity, but I think in obesity and nutrition, there's a huge potential here as well to talk with people who are struggling to change their diets and see what can help them change the way they eat and change their physical activity patterns. And definitely the Good Food Nation Bill is also a huge opportunity for policymakers to work together with social justice departments, with rural economy and connectivity with environment and with health, to look at food with really a comprehensive approach and see how we can bring these different issues together and find a good framework, create a good framework that enables us to act and solve this.
Your time, what I was going to do just finally is to ask each of you, the participants, just to give us a 10 seconds, your ask of what we should be doing now here with the powers that we have, what could we do? And you've got 10 seconds or so each.
Okay, we would ask you to support the need for regulation on issues like price promotions across advertising and marketing and portion size across the retail and out-of-home sector.
I would ask you to implement our existing strategies at scale and with resource.
Ian?
Sustained long-term investment.
Thank you. Claire?
We would want to look at a coordinated approach across portfolios to prevent obesity, ensuring that we address inequalities and not widen the gap any further.
Linda.
So I would just call for a comprehensive strategy that focuses on the individual and society. I talked about the four Ps. Those are very much population-level interventions, but we also need potentially primary care and other interventions to support individuals.
We would ask you to work really hard to make the Good Food Nation Bill a very ambitious piece of legislation that links food, farming and health, and that uses the individual, social, material framework to look at all these different levels.
The BDA would ask you to lead an effective and joined up approach across the life course and to allocate adequate funding to support the development, implementation, evaluation and research around a national plan.
And finally, Drew.
Well, I agree with all the points my colleagues have made, but I just want to emphasise a point that Joyce made earlier on about co-producing solutions to this. Too much of what we do is top-down, is doing things to people rather than with people. Second point is to require the public sector to do what it can to reduce the obesogenic environment in places where it's entirely within their control.
Okay, thank you all very much. That was very interesting this morning, and thanks for attending. Can I suspend briefly till we change the panel, please?
got the minister here for?
Okay. Can I welcome to the committee Aileen Campbell, Minister for Public Health, Fergus Millen, Creighton Health Team Leader, Health Improvement Division, and Derek Grieve, Head of Active Scotland, all Scottish Government. Can I invite the Minister to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for the opportunity to say a few words. And I welcome the fact that the committee is taking time to look at what is probably the most pressing public health issue of our time, and an issue that's not unique to Scotland, but as usual, we appear at the wrong end of the league table. The government approach to this issue is underpinned by a simple mantra, one that holds true even as our understanding and knowledge of how to tackle this complex problem grows. We all need to eat less, eat better, and be more active. Obesity can reduce people's overall quality of life, create a strain on health services, and lead to illness and premature death due to its association with serious chronic conditions such as type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, including hypertension and stroke, and a range of cancers. On its own, the likely cost of diabetes to NHS Scotland is estimated at around £1 billion per annum, and much of that is avoidable. Obesity used to be an exception to the social patterning seen in other non-communicable diseases. Essentially, every SIMD in Scotland was gaining weight. However, more recent years have shown some progress in more affluent communities at the same time as the prevalence of obesity in more deprived communities has increased. And that can be seen particularly in the Primary 1 data, which highlights the divergence between the well-off and poorest in our society that may well be behind the plateauing we're seeing in the recent health survey data. We published the Prevention of Obesity Roadmap in 2010, and that established a solid base building on the foundations on diet and physical activity laid by previous administrations. And we should recognise the good progress we have made in some areas. For example, on food and nutrition as well as physical activity, Scotland's education system has a good story to tell. The food served in Scottish schools has to meet high nutritional standards, and together with implementation of Curriculum for Excellence, we have made great strides in providing children and young people with the knowledge and skills they need to make healthy food choices. Coupled with that, this government is delighted that 98% of primary and secondary schools across Scotland continue to provide at least 2 hours or 2 periods of PE, which we know can have a positive impact on a pupil's health, educational attainment and life chances. However, we're not complacent, and the government will continue to support schools and local authorities to drive improvements in school food and food education. And having good strategies is important, very important, but clearly not enough. And we do know that when we get our interventions right, they can be outstanding. But a response to obesity cannot rely on just a few projects, no matter how impactful. This is about reshaping the environment in which we live to make the healthier choice, not just the easy choice, but a change to our ways of living that impact all the time. So in conclusion, the government recognises there are no silver bullets, and we have to adopt an approach that focuses on a range of actions which will help deliver and support a wider cultural change to our lifestyle. We recognise that there continues to be challenge in terms of seeing behaviour change on a scale large enough to make an impact. Tackling the obesogenic crisis and creating a cultural change cannot be delivered by the NHS or through public health alone. We need wider society to see value in this, and we need you and other leaders to help reshape our relationship with food and activity. So I therefore welcome this chance to discuss these issues with the committee as I prepare to consider how our policies should continue forward and how we in civic society can engage with the public in establishing the necessary culture change. And I'm keen to bring coherence and clarity to our messages on obesity, and I sincerely again look forward to working with you and the rest of the committee on this agenda. So thank you.
Thanks very much, Minister. The previous panel unanimously agreed that it was an obesity crisis. Do you agree with that assessment?
I think, you know, when I was outlined in my opening remarks, the cost in terms of, you know, diabetes alone shows how much of a challenge and how much of a problem that persists in Scotland. And that's despite, as I think some of your the previous panel suggested, that's despite having a number of the policies in place to try and tackle that. So absolutely, the scale of the problem that we face in Scotland is significant, and we need to redouble our efforts in which
we try and tackle that, not just for the here and now in terms of the health benefits tackling obesity will create, but also in the preventative sense that it allows us to stop the impact that it's having on our health service and on public services more generally. So yeah, absolutely, there is a significant problem which Scotland has to face.
I'm asking not in any effort to embarrass you or anything like that, but I think if we all accept that there is a crisis, then that gets us to a starting point where we're all recognising the seriousness of it. Do you think that's an unfair word to use, or is it accurate to reflect what you think?
Again, I'm not trying to deflect away from the seriousness of this. I think what we have in Scotland is a realisation across a number of different areas now, a number of different professions, a number of different disciplines, that this is something that we need to refocus and refresh, and that's why we've committed to looking at the obesity and refreshing that strategy next year, and that's why we're pleased that the committee is looking at this, and the range of people you had speaking earlier on will input into our thinking as we take that forward. I think as others have said, then this problem is significant in Scotland. The seriousness of it is huge, and we need to, I think, though, also be mindful of our language as well, because of the sensitivities around some of that as well, in which people and how people feel. So I think your panel earlier decided that it was a crisis. I think we all agree on that the problem is significant in Scotland, and we need to refocus, refresh our approach, making sure that we bring together not just leaders in yourselves as the committee, but also civic society as well, to make sure that we focus and face the same way in Scotland, recognising that Scotland has to unpick generations now of overeating, less activity, and choices that are less healthy.
Alex.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Obviously, before you took this brief, you were the Minister for Children and Young People, and we did a lot of work together over a number of years in that regard. I'm very glad about that, because actually I think a lot of this agenda is about children and about prevention, early intervention. The last panel we heard quite a lot about, first of all, place and promotion, and in terms of place, lack of availability, particularly in deprived communities, of access to fresh and nutritional ingredients and products, but also advertising, that in a lot of our advertising is targeted at our younger generations. Now, obviously, this Parliament is not entirely in control of advertising agenda, but there are things we can do. I just wonder if you would sketch out for us where you're coming from in terms of what you think we can do in this Parliament to reduce the exposure of our young people to marketing and promotions within our supermarkets and peer pressure and the rest of it.
And certainly on the issue around promotion and or marketing anyway, I wrote to the UK government to see if they would reconsider their position on advertising, junk food advertising before the watershed. I think we've yet to get a response to that request. And if they don't reconsider it, we'd like to open up discussions around whether or not those powers could come to us. But I think the point that you make is a good one, and I think this chimes nicely with our refocus and our refresh on the obesity strategy, because it will give us a chance and an opportunity in that more broader sense to look at ways in which we can take a lead. But some of these things are tricky, and I guess that's where it's useful to have this dialogue with you as the committee about where Parliament wants to see us take this obesity strategy refresh, about where the parameters might be, where you would like us to focus our efforts on, where you think we should be taking a lead in the way that we can look towards public policy around minimum unit pricing or on tobacco as well. Scotland took quite brave and bold decisions on those areas. This is an issue that probably has a degree of greater sensitivity. A lot of time people will consider things like tobacco, smoking, over consumption of alcohol, or something that somebody else does somewhere else. We all eat. There is a cultural change that we need across the country, so there are greater sensitivities. And of course, some of those bolder policies got a degree of kickback. So I guess it's it'd be useful to I suppose, continue this dialogue, continue that work to see where we should be pushing a wee bit more, where Scotland can take the lead. We're keen that we need to make a difference on this issue. We can't afford to plateau on this issue as possibly the statistics might indicate we have. And we need to, I think, consider everything as we look at our obesity strategy, which we'll bring for consultation next year.
Okay, Ivan.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks, Minister, for coming to talk to us. There I want to focus on is round about the preventative area and preventative spend in particular. And it was interesting to hear in your opening remarks that you put a number out there of $1 billion, I think, which was diabetes spend. Just taking a step back, the Christie Commission talked about up to 40% of public sector spend was as a consequence of things that could have been prevented earlier. It's a big number. I don't know if I'd buy into that, but certainly that in the health budget would be somewhere north of $5 billion. So I think you're $1 billion. We're starting to get into the right kind of ballpark, which is good to hear. And the reason I focus on that is because it's a couple of things. First of all, it informs where we spend money in a preventative sense. But also, we're happy to talk about how much more money we need when things are getting worse. But should we turn the corner on obesity, then in theory you would be freeing up resources, which would be a nice place to be. So I suppose I'd just like to reflect on what data you're aware of that is there that would allow us to inform that debate, what the consequences of making improvements in that area would be financially. And then the second part of it, also in the preventative thing, is health's kind of one of the departments that suffers as a consequence of other things that happen across society and government. You tend to pick up the pieces of things that are caused elsewhere in terms of the health outcomes. How much cross-government work and how much support do you feel you've got? Because we talked this morning, there's areas, things in planning and transport, potentially in education and regulation, you name it, have all got a downstream impact on health outcomes and spend. Is that, do you feel that's kind of coherent and joined up at a government level?
The Christie Commission that was published, I think now, it was 2011, I think it was published, so still relevant now, challenged us all to work out how we move away from silo working, move away from progressing a stream of work in one area without reflecting on the crossover with other areas. And that was as much a challenge for the wider public sector as it is for government as well. And so, of course, yeah, we work across the government, which is why there is significant investment in active travel, which is why there's significant investment in SysTrans and such like as well, because we understand the need to be working across portfolios, across disciplines and across different boundaries. It's why our National Strategic Group on Activity also includes representation from SNH, from Transport Scotland and others. It's why the walking strategy is taken forward and is chaired by the group that chairs and leads the walking strategy is chaired by the chair of RTPI from the Planning Institute as well. So there's areas we can point to where we're working with beyond the usual suspects and making sure that we're trying to make inroads into areas which need to understand that they have an impact on that public health agenda. They might not clearly associate it with it, but certainly I think that's part of why we need to build more momentum across the whole of civic society, across the whole of the public sector, to make sure that we can focus and face the same way to make the inroads into this area in the best way that we can, and also make sense in terms of the public purse to be able to bring and collect our resources together. Now, can there be improvements in that? No doubt there can be. There has to be, because your last panel, as I was listening, were talking about the issues around the implementation on the ground level. So there is still a job of work for us to do to make sure that that's as cohesive as we can get it. And of course, we can always make improvements and always strive to make improvements in our work across government. In terms of the preventative spend, I think, you know, that's a clear one around the $1 billion spent on, or the cost to type 2 diabetes. You know, some of those things are preventable. If we can prevent them, then that's a cost that we don't have to bear. But you know, at the same time, preventative spend is always probably more easy to say than it is to kind of shift that focus, shift that tank around to ensure that that's what we are doing, because we're still having to deal with the fact that people now need to be helped to cope with their conditions. So Christie Commission is as relevant now as it's ever been. We need to be more disciplined in our focus, I think, and we need to ensure that we use this opportunity and that refresh of the obesity strategy to make sure that we bring together across a number of disciplines to ensure that we get the impact that we want and that we seek.
Thanks.
Minister, in your opening statement, you acknowledge the fact that there is a clear link between obesity and deprivation, particularly obviously amongst women and children. If we just look at one example, around fuel poverty, if somebody can't afford to pay their gas bills, can't afford to pay their electricity bills, then obviously they can't afford to cook or prepare a healthy meal. So why do you think the existing strategy has failed to make inroads when it comes to tackling obesity, particularly in areas where we have the most deprivation?
There's probably a number of reasons as well, and I think you probably alluded to. There's generational issues, there's probably educational issues, and there's probably a whole host of other societal issues as well at play there too. I don't think anyone is pretending that this is a simple or easy thing to solve, and I think everyone recognises that the way in which our statistics indicate that there are particular problems in areas of deprivation show that we need to have a much stronger focus on making a difference in those communities. Likewise, the fuel poverty issue, I mean, the fact that people can't afford not just to buy the food, but actually can't afford to cook the food either, is something that we need to ensure is part of the focus going forward. It has been a focus. There has been attention there, but clearly we need to demonstrate much greater improvement than we have seen. I don't know if Hair Figures, do you want to add anything?
I also look after health and equalities policy, and one of the big pushes we tried over the last few years was to get the government to take more attention to tackling inequalities. I think you see that's happening. And if you tackle inequalities, a lot of things you would do to tackle inequalities will impact on people's health generally, and it'll impact on obesity. So these all things go together. And I think it's so the work we've done on inequalities will contribute to that. But it's changed how we're approaching that's changed and we'll see the results of that over the course of the next few years, I think.
So but the figures at the moment show quite clearly that it's not having an impact, that obesity levels in deprived areas are certainly growing.
I think these sort of figures don't change dramatically overnight. These are, you're going to have to follow this trend, and what you want to see is the movement of the figures over a course of a number of years. When we first started writing the obesity strategy in 08-09 for publication in 2010, inequalities wasn't deemed an issue. As the Minister said, it affected everybody in Scotland. There were some groups of people, the women in particular, were from deprived areas, were maybe outliers there. But what we've seen over the last few years is the separation of the different SIMD zones, and it's only appeared in the last few years. And it's particularly apparent with children, I would say. But if you actually look at adults, they've not quite separated fully yet. And it's interesting. So maybe adults have taken on board some of the messages, and particularly in the well-off communities, they've taken on board the messages. They're doing things for their kids, but they haven't actually quite taken on board that message for themselves yet. They've not committed to giving up their glass of wine at night or eating more healthily, and their kids are doing it. And so the adults are just not quite at the same place as the kids are in terms of the inequalities.
So do you see there's a need to change, when it comes to the refresh strategy, there's a need to change the strategy, or is it about the implementation of the strategy?
We'd always said from the outset that we'd have a focus on inequalities. We'd target our resources where we could in our activity on those most deprived communities, and that's what we've done. So we've tried to do that anyway from the outset. But you, this is a long-term thing. You're not going to see immediate results very quickly. We're in this for the long game. This is going to take decades to turn around.
In terms of targeting the areas of most need, can you evidence that where that's happening, where significant resource is being taken from one area and redirected into an area of most need?
I can't give you that myself, because the resources will go out to the health boards and out to the local authorities, and they'll be diverting those resources.
But we have, policies that are continuing to make an improvement across the piece. You know, primary 1 to 3 now have free school meals, a nutritious meal. The nutrition value of those meals as good as it has been. We have a number of areas of work around what we're trying to do in terms of encouraging activity as well, and that's around making sure that that's accessible for our areas of most that suffer most deprivation. But we also have to realise as well, as I think your previous panel noted, that the areas of deprivation are far more susceptible to some of the more difficult decisions that they're having to make around making their income go further, around choosing or being unnecessarily forced down a path where they have to, where they sometimes take the unhealthy option. So we have to make sure that in this refocus and the refresh that we do tackle inequalities and that we understand the choices that families are having to make, find ways in which we can help them, the investment we're making around some of the allowing more deprived areas to have access to fresher, healthier food has seen investment from the government as well. So these are issues that we've got policies in place, we've invested in them, and we need to build upon that to make the difference that I think we all seek.
Do you want to come back in?
And maybe a very good example is Football Fans in Training, which is obviously focused in on the football clubs. And we've asked them from the outset to focus on people within their fan base from the more deprived areas, which they're often drawn from. And so that's a very specific example of where we're actually picking up people from that particular area, and it's a very successful project.
We may come back to that. Alison?
Thank you for joining us this morning. You'll be very well aware that Scotland has the worst weight outcomes of all UK nations, so I very much welcome the Minister's statement that this is a most pressing public health issue. But I think it's fair to say our previous panel would agree that it doesn't feel like a national priority at the moment. I mean, Dr. Drew Walker pointed out that this is entirely preventable, but it's costing the NHS hundreds of millions each year. So I would like to ask how, and Professor Nanette Mutri made the point as well, that we have lots of fantastic policy that we're simply failing to implement and we're not investing in it. So I'd kind of like to understand what is going to change. I mean, we saw the complete removal of funding for Jog Scotland. We know that last year only 1.2% of journeys in Scotland were made by bike. We have a vision for that to be 10% by 2020. And the Minister spoke of significant investment in active travel, but I'd also like to ask the Minister if, talking about a cross-cutting portfolio, will you be speaking to Humza Yousaf and perhaps suggesting that he invests more than, well, less, he currently invests less than 2% of a very big transport budget in walking and cycling? Are those the kind of changes that we can expect to be put in place while we wait on the refresh?
Well, we already invest significantly in active travel, a record investment of £39.2 million per year in active travel, and continue to do that and continue to make the investment. And of course, we'll continue to have discussions with other policy leads and other ministers with other areas of interest that relate to helping us tackle this problem of obesity. And I think, you know, a lot of the evidence and the investment does stack up to that cross-cutting nature. Now, can there be improvements? Of course there can be improvements, and we'll continue to need improvements. But actually, you know, in terms of walking, there has been a great improvement through having that focus on walking. We have seen an increase of, I think, around 5% in walking, and a reduction in the weight of people participating in walking as well. So there's a clear indication of where government does put a focus. We can expect to see quite quick results, even though the longer term benefits will be a wee bit further down the road before we start to see the impact across the country. But we are investing in areas like active travel, making sure that we do work across portfolios, and we'll continue to make sure that the policies that we have can be implemented and we can feel the impact of that in a positive sense across the country.
I think I'm just making the point that perhaps ministerial colleagues are making this more difficult than it might be. 39 million may be a record for this government, but I would still suggest that it is far too low, given that 50% of Scots, as we know, don't have access to a car. I think you know, really suitable, appropriate investment in this area could help address inequality markedly. We know from international evidence that in countries where a lot of people cycle, it's those on the lowest incomes who tend to gain most advantage. And, you know, if we look at the Jog Scotland programme, for example, there's a lot of evidence to suggest that that was very good at addressing inequalities. Lots of people who took part in that programme were perhaps women in their 40s who, you know, might not be comfortable about attending a gym. They liked the fact that the costs were low, that they could do it in their own neighbourhood. So I'd just be...
We've had a focus on the walking strategy. If walking is free of charge, everyone can do it. But we have to make the conditions right for people to participate. But I think that's a positive thing, though, that Scotland has seen a 5% increase in walking. And, you know, as a result of a cross-portfolio focus on trying to improve upon where we have been. And, you know, that, as I said, you know, the walking group that we have, that strategic group, is chaired by the chair of RTPI. So again, you're not bringing planning into this as well. But you know, nobody's saying these things without understanding and being cognizant of the improvements that we need to make and continue to make as well, about making sure that things like active travel are much more keenly and routinely felt within the planning decisions that are getting taken as well. So we have to make, and it's across not just public health, it's across the whole of wider civic society and public life more generally. But I think we can point to areas like walking, which is free of charge, which we have invested in Paths for All to ensure that we can allow more people to participate in this this pastime, which improves their fitness, their well-being, and helps us tackle some of these problems that we're facing.
Can I just ask them, Professor Nanette Mutrie made the point that she thinks there's a lot of very good policy out there, and clearly there have been improvements, which I warmly welcome too, but there was a feeling from the panel that they're not being implemented because of lack of resourcing. Now, clearly local authorities' budgets have suffered. How does the Minister, how will you enable local authorities to deliver some of these programmes given that reduced budget?
But local government has been given a settlement that's fair. That's not to take away the fiscal challenges that everybody across public life is facing. I think, going back to Christie, the principles of the Christie Commission, I think that means that we have to, and we require a much more disciplined approach that will see us bring our collective resources to bear to make the improvements that we need to make. You know, Alec Cole-Hamilton in his earlier line of questioning talked around the early years work that we took forward together when he had his role in Aberlour. You know, one of the things around the early years task force was about bringing together local government, NHS and government together to pool our resources a bit more effectively. Now, that's one example of where that can bring about the differences that I think we need to see. But I think in terms of your point there, I think that's why we need to probably push a bit more and work much more collaboratively with local authorities, with the NHS and others, bring together our resources and work out where we'll have the greatest impact. And some of the things that we're talking around, like walking around the football fans and training, actually are really incredibly cost effective and don't cost a huge amount. So sometimes some of the solutions, some of the answers don't cost a huge amount, but the impact can be quite transformative. So I think it's around working together more collaboratively, working together with a common purpose, with an understanding of what we want to do and what we want to achieve. And I think that's where the opportunity for the refresh strategy will take us when we go out to consultation about what are the things that Scotland needs to do differently in order to make the impact that we need.
Thank you, Convener.
Can I, on this local government fairness thing, can I ask if it's fair that my local authority in West Lothian, which was named UK Council of the Year in 2006 for being an effective, well-run local authority, has had £90 million taken from its budget, impacting on active travel, pensioners groups, physical activity groups, sport, all of that stuff that feeds in to this very important issue. That cannot be fair, surely.
Well, the Scottish Government's budget has been cut as well. And actually what we've managed to do, though, is to provide a settlement for local government which is fair. It's not diminishing the financial challenges that we all face, but the government has provided a fair settlement for the local government in the backdrop of our own budget being quite cut quite considerably from Westminster.
Previous panel touched upon the health, child health surveillance data, which we use, and how that's reformed. As part of the refresh strategy, do you agree that maybe we should look at introducing secondary school level data to be recorded as well. And on a separate point, you mentioned that 98% of pupils are now receiving 2 hours of physical education in school. Do you think that's actually quality PE in these cases?
Okay. So I heard the comment made, and I think, you know, certainly the consensus of opinion from your previous panel seemed to be suggest that they thought that this would be a good idea to embark upon the monitoring at secondary school level of children's or young people's weight. And that's certainly something that we'll commit to looking at and considering as well. In terms of the quality, you know, we've come from a base of, I think it was 10% in 2004-05 up to 98% now. I mean, that's a huge and significant increase that I don't think we should take away from. And, you know, this has been work in progress between our active schools with Sport Scotland and the Scottish Government. And, you know, the quality, I believe, is there. Derek, do you want to?
In rolling out and increasing the delivery of the PE target, Education Scotland colleagues worked very closely with schools. So as well as increasing the volume, there's been a lot of work both within schools and indeed across schools to ensure that quality is driven up as well.
Richard.
Thank you very much, convener. Morning, Minister. You said earlier that the public accepted basically several laws that the government's brought in over the last couple of years, are one of which is still ongoing, minimum pricing, smoking, etc. The question I want to ask you is, the previous panel basically was suggesting that we should regulate the food industry, and especially the big names, the Tesco's, the Sainsbury's, bring in taxes, which I don't think they're going to like too much if we did. What's your view? Should we regulate or educate people in regards to this, if you want to call it, as some people are, this crisis?
Well, I certainly think we should educate. You know, I think regardless of anyone's views and opinions on the regulation, I think, you know, and we strive to do through curriculum for excellence, and through a whole host of other areas as well. Indeed, you know, and that extends beyond the school classroom into youth work and a whole host of other sectors which take their responsibilities seriously around the children and young people in their care. I think around the regulation, I think you touch upon an issue that it shows how complicated this issue and area of policy is. I think when you look at the minimum unit pricing, when that was something that wasn't supported necessarily wholly by some elements of the industry, I think it shows the trickiness in trying to move forward in these areas. So what I think we need to do, I think, is, and what I think the strategy refocus and refresh will allow us to do, is to have that wider debate about where civic society wants to push us. Where does the committee want us to go? What are your thoughts as leaders within your own parties and within your own communities as well? What are the areas that you think government should be looking at as we try to find solutions and find ways to solve this problem that is significant to Scotland and is costing our public services a significant amount of money? I certainly think, you know, as a starter, we should be looking at the ensuring that the junk food advertising is not being exposed to children before the watershed. I think that would be something that would be quite straightforward, has been called for by not just us in the Scottish Government, but our counterparts in other areas of the UK and other health professionals across the UK as well. So I think, you know, I would hope that the UK government can reconsider this and that we can make progress on that.
What role do you think the Food Standards Scotland has in this, challenging, you know, the food industry and shops and, you know, the big grocers and formulating, you know, and promoting a better, healthier way of eating, you know?
Well, they have a national leadership role as well, a role to provide authoritative sources of advice and evidence, and to work with other partners about trying to ensure that there is clear guidance around people's approaches to purchasing, or people's approaches to food more generally, and they're also well placed through that separate role, that the separate kind of position that they have to government to provide challenge to industry as well. So they have an important role to play.
If you allow me, Convener, one last question. Well, they're talking about the sugar tax and drinks, etc. What do you think about a levy on unhealthy foods?
You know, again, some of these issues, no doubt, will come out through the consultation that we take forward. But you know, I think what was clear from your last evidence session is that there is a desire there for Scotland to be bold on this issue, where we have seen that boldness around tobacco and alcohol. We've seen the health benefits come through as well. So, I this is an opportunity, I think, to really flush out what things people think that we should be doing, where we need to increase our efforts, what more we need to do, how do we properly implement some good policies that we have there in place. But also we have to work and be mindful of some of the sensitivities that exist there. And it's not going to be an easy area to, or an easy journey to embark upon. But I think, you know, the consultation gives us a chance to really talk openly about what tools we have, what tools can make a difference, and how we choose to proceed forward and trying to cope and deal with this issue that Scotland has around obesity.
Thank you.
Claire, then Alex.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister, for joining us this morning. And we heard from the earlier panel their concern around about price promotion on some of this higher sugar, higher calorie foods. And I was quite staggered by some of the figures in the cancer research paper. 53% of regular soft drinks were purchased as a result of price promotion. I wonder if the Minister could perhaps give us her thoughts on price promotion here. We've, the Scottish Government, looked at price promotion, particularly with alcohol and multi-buys, and perhaps this would be something that they would give some consideration to with regards to sugary drinks, high sugar and high fat, dense calorie foods.
Absolutely. We'll consider that as part of the strategy and the consultation that we'll embark upon as well. I think, you know, even seeing the talk of the sugar levy as well has begun to see some change behaviour from industry. I think Tesco are starting to reformulate Lucozade, I think from memory as well, as another example. So there's already changes in industry at the moment through the notion of the sugar levy. So absolutely, we'll consider that as part of the refreshed on the strategy.
Thank you.
Hey, Alex. I'd like to draw on Miles Briggs' question, and again, you might want to reflect on your experiences as Minister for Children and Young People in your answer on this as well. I think it's fair to say that the SNP are to be applauded for what's happened in PE, and that draws cross-party support in terms of the 98% now getting the 2 hours a week. But I think whilst this government has given with one hand, it is arguably taken away with the other in terms of the decline in access to youth work that children and young people have. So for those crucial times out of school hours, the access to physical activity, things like, you know, the decline of the community education department at Strathclyde University means we're not churning out qualified youth workers in the way that we were anymore. And still we have this repeated barrier across our communities where brilliant facilities are inaccessible on weekends due to being tied up with other kind of sporting and clubs events, or they're just financially prohibitive. What steps will your government take to mitigate that and to promote and boost access to youth work?
Okay, well, we have, in terms of youth work, we have, I think Scotland takes a lead in comparison to many other parts of the UK around our approach to youth work and our strategy, our youth work strategy, and participation in a number of different, from memory, the uniform groups, for instance, is going up. As ever, when things around youth work, the problem is trying to always entice volunteers to come forward as well so that they can provide those opportunities too. But we have to do what we can to ensure that continues, and we have, I think, quite a good story to tell around youth work. Sorry, you want to come back?
No, I absolutely agree. We've got a really shiny strategy about youth work, but unfortunately, with the cuts to local government, we're seeing paid youth workers laid off. We're seeing diminished access, rolling, you know, we had a really good meeting in Muir House, a community in my constituency last week with a number of youth work providers, all of whom are uncertain as to whether they will still have contracts this time next year because of local government financial uncertainty. Now, I admit that's a decision that's taken at a local level, but that's about funding priorities from this government as well. So whilst the strategy is brilliant, the delivery on the ground isn't meeting that.
We can point to increased participation in amongst some of the youth work organisations as well, and you know, and we do have a good strategy in place, and we have seen great improvements in youth work as well. The youth awards, participation in youth awards as well, has gone up exponentially as well, which is accredited across by the SQA. And we also have in this portfolio, we have the Active Schools Network as well, which is providing a greater opportunity for young people in a community sense as well. Also, we met and exceeded our target for community hubs, which has been taken forward by Sports Scotland as well. And as they move forward in terms of trying to further increase the number of community sports hubs, we'll be looking at ways in which we can look to areas of increased deprivation around how we can enhance and increase the opportunities that young people have to participate in sport and participate in activity more generally as well. We have some of the best facilities that we've ever had across the country. Now we have to make sure that we're breaking down those barriers to ensure that everybody gets an opportunity to use them. But I think, you know, around youth work, we have a good story to tell. In our Active Schools Network, we have another equally positive story to tell as well, which has been I think also enhanced by the community hubs, which have seen a significant investment from Sports Scotland and the Scottish Government to ensure that young people in areas across the country have access to a variety of different sports of their choice.
Marie.
Thank you. I was struck when we were looking at the evidence that was submitted that there is probably slightly different strategies required in terms of preventing obesity and in terms of tackling obesity. So when it comes to actually treating the obesity and overweight problem that we have at the moment, more significant is reducing the number of calories that people eat, so affecting the diet rather than the level of activity. So I accept that physical activity can be part of the treatment strategy, but much more significant and much more bang for our buck in terms of affecting policy would be tackling what we're actually eating. I'd be interested in hearing your thoughts on that. I was also struck when we were speaking earlier about with the previous panel about the previous strategies may have actually increased health inequality because many of them were targeted at individual responsibility. And is it maybe time to be thinking very seriously about population level approaches, fiscal strategies and regulation in terms of not further broadening that inequality gap?
I think physical activity has to be part of our approach, and I know that there are lots of different views and opinions, but I think as well the wider benefits that physical activity provides around mental health, general well-being, and also, and while a lot of the focus can be around young people and girls, there's also the older cohort as well, around the necessity for older people to be active as well. Helps with falls prevention, helps with their muscle tone and a whole host of other things. So there's and you know that's a bit of work that we're continuing to do with the care inspector and others around care homes as well. So there's bits of work happening in other parts of the age groups that we need to have a focus and attention on. So I think absolutely for me, physical activity has to be part of our approach, as well as looking at what people eat, because actually physical activity in itself is not going to be enough to outdo the calorie intake that people are consuming. And you're right as well around some of the issues around there being good policies and good pockets of practice in different places. How do we scale that up? So that has to be part of our approach as well, about how we make that population level change. But again, going back to the walking, you know, that 5% increase as well, you know, that's through a lot of collaborative work, a lot of focus on an issue and an area that we know we can make a difference. And then we've seen that difference happen quite quickly. So while some of the benefits are going to be felt longer term, we can make inroads and have some quick wins. And that short, medium, longer term, those goals we will need to be how we move forward with the strategy refocus.
Minister, you said you wanted to hear the committee's views on how we take this forward. I'd be also keen to hear your views on that. If we look at the issue of smoking and alcohol, governments took, I think, brave and bold decisions, taking on vested interests in order to move that agenda on. I think in order to really get into this and start to make impact, we need to take on some of those vested interests again. Now, some of the issues you mentioned lie with the UK government, but there are issues lying with the powers in this parliament. So what I'm really asking is, you know, your view as to whether, or your, what you would say to the, my question, which is, are you going to take on those vested interests with the powers that you have here in order to make a real impact on some of the issues that we've been discussing this morning and continue to lobby elsewhere where that's required?
I think that's why the obesity strategy moving forward is going, the opportunity that we have to have that dialogue and that consultation in the run-up to the strategy is so important, because I guess that will allow us to look for ways in which we can be innovative and bold and make the differences that we seek to bring about. But that is going to be, it's going to be quite a challenge, and that's why I guess, you know, I was asking, you know, I was suggesting that the committee might want to come forward with some of their views and opinions as well, because we at this point in time we're quite open-minded, and but we have a determination to make a difference, and we'll need to roll up our sleeves, and if there are ways in which we can bring about the changes that around the problems that Scotland faces with obesity, then we'll have to look seriously and look hard at how we manage that and how we move it forward. But this, you know, the areas around minimum unit pricing, that was the whole parliament came behind some of those bold decisions and bold moves, and I think that's where we need to be as well, and be mindful that this isn't just about winning hearts and minds here in the parliament, but this is about the wider society as well, and the sensitivities around looking at bulk buys, looking at the price, and you know, some of these things are going to be quite difficult and challenging topics, but we have, I think, a collective determination to make the improvements that we need to see in Scotland, and that the public purse is feeling and facing at the moment. So I think the opportunity lies around the consultation and the strategy, and gives us a chance to raise the dialogue and raise the debate around what we do as a country and how we approach and how we respond to the problems that Scotland is facing.
OK, do you want to make any final point? No. OK. Thank you very much for your attendance this morning. Appreciate that. And we'll suspend briefly. Thank you. Oh, no, sorry. We're now going to private session. Sorry.